So let us continue with the subject. And this is the last topic. The title of this topic is Atmospheric Boundary Layer. And there's three main subtopics under this topic. We're going to talk about the mean boundary layer characteristics, the mean boundary layer characteristics, the statistical description of turbulence, and finally the energy balance of the surface. So first one, mean boundary layer characteristics. You've seen this many times already, right? This is the Earth, and then the closest layer, atmospheric layer to the Earth is called the boundary layer. And sometimes we can guess the height of the boundary layer by the presence of cloud. That means the topmost or bottommost layer height of the cloud shows us or gives us a hint of how high the boundary layer is. So if when you see the clouds there, then you see that the bottom or the top, somewhere in the middle, even the average, then you can guess that if you know the height between the Earth and the cloud is about 1 kilometer, then we can guess the height of the boundary layer to be about 1 kilometer. Now the troposphere includes this boundary layer up to the tropopause. So the troposphere can go up to 11 kilometers. So the troposphere is not the boundary layer, it's just a boundary layer is a part of the troposphere. And it's about 10% most of the time it's 10% of the height of the troposphere. The layer under study here for this topic is this boundary layer. So it's a surface that's close to the Earth, and then this is the layer that we live in, that we model in. For example, your air pollution modeling is modeling the dispersion of pollution within the boundary layer. So why is this boundary layer important? Well, like what I said, people spend most of their lives in the atmospheric boundary layer. So I'm going to use this ABL acronym quite a lot. Pollution is trapped in the ABL. You can think of the boundary layer as a cap or the height. The topmost boundary layer is a cap of pollution. The pollution won't rarely exceeds through the boundary layer to go to the upper layer. Fog and frost occur in the boundary layer. Aviation, shipping, other activities are in the ABL. Crops are grown in ABL. Okay, notice that these two is related to the economy, right? Logistics and agriculture. And that relates to economy or how well the economy is for a certain country. So, you know, just a fun fact is that the meteorological department in Malaysia is under the, which ministry? It's under Science and Technology Ministry, right? But in the US, the meteorology department is under the economy ministry. So to show you how tightly linked meteorology is with the economy, and that's why it's important for us to study meteorology. And pollen is distributed in ABL. Sometimes pollen can be considered as a pollutant as well. And you know the air quality modeling that you use, you can use the same model to also model the dispersion of pollen in the atmosphere. Thunderstorm and hurricane evolution are also tied to the inflow of moist ABL. That means if you have high content of water in the atmospheric boundary layer, it also contributes to the generation of thunderstorms and hurricanes. Now, over in other parts of the world, the hurricane and thunderstorms could come from other regions of the Earth, but in Malaysia, mostly we are confined in our small space here because we are protected by Indonesia and also protected by, say, in Penang, exactly, from the east coast of Malaysia. We're in the west coast, right? So our weather is mostly influenced by this, by local, regional, local influences. So the rain, like I said, the rain that we get right now, the heavy rain is mostly generated within the same area. It doesn't come from very far locations most of the time. So first thing we need to consider is how thick the atmospheric boundary layer is. So this thickness is not, we mentioned just now it's about 1 kilometer in height, but then they vary quite a bit in time and space. It could range from just a few hundreds of meters to a few kilometers. And that would change depending on the time of day. And we can see this variation in the next slide, and I'll show you that later. So by day, when the Earth's surface is heated by the sun, it's warm in the surface, there is vigorous thermal mixing. Can you imagine this in your head? In the atmosphere, which causes the boundary layer to extend up to 1 or 2 kilometers. So, it could even go up to like maybe 3 kilometers and so on, but it's within this order of magnitude of 1 to, say, 5 kilometers. At night, when the Earth's surface cools down, the air near the surface becomes more stable, and you've seen this term before in the air quality modeling subject, right? And this stable atmospheric condition would suppress mixing. There'd be less mixing in the atmosphere. And that would also reduce the height of the boundary layer, even down to 100 meters. That's quite short. And even some buildings could be above the boundary layer at night in areas where the buildings are tall. So let's look at the variation of the boundary layer. How does it actually change with time of day? So over here, okay, diurnal variation means daily changes, so daily variation from morning to night. Let's see, this is within the ABL. Inside here, this is above the ABL. Okay, for this line here, it's within the ABL, and for this line here, it's above the ABL. So in the ABL, you can see the temperature changes. They're quite large, aren't they? From about 15 degrees Celsius up to 25 degrees Celsius and go down to 15. So there's about 10 degree difference change. And then, but then above the ABL, notice that the variation is very more stable. It changes, but not as much change as in the inside the ABL. By the way, this is for one day. In the middle there is noon. So this is one diurnal cycle. And then this is the second day, another diurnal cycle. And this is the third day and so on. Of course, the zeta is over in Layton, Oklahoma. But then it's not the actual value that we're concerned with. We're just looking at the changes that happen. So the only difference between that area and our in Malaysia, for example, is just the temperature, the actual magnitude of temperature, but not the actual variation. Now, this variation is caused by the forcing of the surface. What causes this change is actually the surface. So the closer it is to the surface, then the higher effect of the surface onto the atmospheric parameters. The further it is away, like say this one, then the less forcing of the surface. So be familiar with this term forcing because that's quite a common term to use to describe this situation. By the way, here they write 97.5 kilopascal and so on. This one just to show the height. Remember, there is a relationship between pressure and height. Closer to the ground, higher pressure. Further away from the ground, lower pressure. So you can see here, 85 kilopascal means higher above ground. 97.5 kilopascal is somewhere closer to the ground. It's actually a more accurate way of measuring height instead of giving us the actual height. So be more comfortable with using pressure as the height instead of the actual height in meters. So that's why it's a bit counterintuitive here because we think that this is a bit higher and this is lower, right? But actually it's the other way around. Now, strong diurnal variation in the atmospheric boundary layer over land, especially during the summer. Over here, it's always summer, right? So we can expect in Malaysia, in tropical regions, that the variation, there's a strong diurnal variation. That means very large, very tall atmospheric boundary layer during the day and then very small atmospheric boundary layer, or very short atmospheric boundary layer at night. And and then if it's above the ABL, then there's less diurnal variation in the free atmosphere or somewhere above the atmospheric boundary layer.